essay, before you get to the notes, and just before the epilogue, he's talking about consolation. All this is part of that fourth thing that fairy stories offer, which is consolation. And he's talking about the kinds of things we seek escape from. And he finally talks about, you know, the greatest thing we seek escape from, which is death. But then he goes on and says, but the consolation of fairy tales has another aspect than the imaginative satisfaction of ancient desires. Far more important is the consolation of the happy ending. Almost, I would venture to assert that all complete fairy stories must have it. At least I would say that tragedy is the true form of drama. It's excuse me, its highest function. But the opposite is true of fairy story. Since we do not appear to possess a word that expresses this opposite, that is, the opposite of tragedy, I will call it eucatastrophe. The eucatastrophic tale is the true form of fairy tale. So, he says, this is the true form of fairy tale. But again, we've got to pick apart what that word really means. The eu is beautiful. A catastrophe is simply a sudden turn. Catastrophe isn't always bad. We tend to think it is. Okay? But a catastrophe can be something wonderful. A woman giving birth to a child is a catastrophe. Why? Her life, if she's married, her husband's life will never be the same. Never. Okay? Everything changes that moment on. Or you could take it back, you know, to beginning pregnancy, etc. Winning the lottery, as an example I've used before, would be a catastrophe. Why? Your life would forever change. Think of Trump becoming president. Some of you are going to say it's a catastrophe in more ways than one. If it were Hillary Clinton, it would be a catastrophe. Why? Her life would never be the same. Who's ever elected president? They never go back to the day before the election. Even after they've served 4 years or 8 years, do you think Barack Obama's life today is the same as it was 8 years ago before he was first elected? Nope. And it never will be. And it never will be for Jimmy Carter, for George H.W. Bush, for Bill Clinton, for George W. Bush, etc. Okay? Each one of those events in their lives was a catastrophe. Sudden? Okay, you could say, you know, they ran for president. They sought this out. Yeah. But what do you really know is going to happen on that second Tuesday or second Monday, whatever it is, in November? It's a roll of the dice. What if the polls, the last couple of elections shown? Can you trust the polls? No. You can't trust the polls anymore. Why? Well, this is one reason. Most polls that are done by telephone are done by landline. The majority of people in the United States use these over landlines. If people are like me, they don't answer the phone when it's election season. All I have to see is either the phone number or something else. If it says GOP, I don't answer it. If it says Democrats, I don't answer it. If it's a number I don't recognize, which during election season, odds are it's a polling company, I don't answer it at all. Okay? That's just me. Statistics will tell you that I'm not just me. I count for something, I don't remember what the number is, but it's something like 10,000 people. That for every me, there are 10,000 like me. That is, 10,000 people who won't answer the phone. Okay? So, that's eucatastrophe. Eucatastrophe, the beautiful turn, the good turn. Okay? That's winning the lottery. Everybody in here would like that. Okay? You would like that kind of catastrophe. I would argue having a child, that's a you catastrophe. That's a beautiful thing. It's a wonderful thing. Okay? But Tolkien goes on and says, the consolation of fairy stories, the joy of the happy ending. Notice he doesn't say the happy ending. And they all lived happily ever after. No, that's not what he's talking about. The joy of the happy ending, or more correctly, of the good catastrophe. The good sudden change that comes at the end. The sudden joyous turn, for there is no true end to any fairy tale. Why not? Because a true fairy tale, in Tolkien's understanding, is ongoing. What has happened merely when you've turned the last page? You stop participating in that fairy tale. But for Meg Murray, Charles Wallace, Mr. Murray, Mrs. Murray, Calvin O'Keefe, the story is still going on. We've just stopped kind of peering through the window, as it were. Okay? So Tolkien says, this joy of the happy ending, which is one of the things which fairy stories can produce supremely well, is not essentially escapist nor fugitive. In its fairy tale or other world, that is, its secondary world, the world that the author gets to, you know, create kind of in your mind, or other world setting, what? It is a sudden and miraculous, and he uses a religious word, grace. What is a grace? Theologically speaking, it's a gift. It's an unearned gift. It's an unmerited gift. Okay? It's a gift you don't deserve, nor is it a gift you expect. Okay? It's a sudden and miraculous grace, never to be counted on to recur. It does not deny the existence of discatastrophe. So this sudden turn doesn't deny this. What does he mean by discatastrophe? Of sorrow and failure. If this is the beautiful sudden turn, everybody knows what this means, even though we don't spell it that way when we use it in English. When you diss somebody, when you badmouth them, okay? So the bad catastrophe, being at the intersection, I don't know, Bell Road, Middle Tennessee Boulevard, getting hit by one of the dump trucks or something. That would not be a good change. Okay? So, it doesn't deny this, Tolkien says. In fact, he goes on and says, it doesn't deny the existence of discatastrophe, of sorrow and failure. The possibility of these is necessary to the joy of deliverance. It denies, in the face of much evidence, if you will. We're going to talk about that phrase in just a moment. Universal final defeat, and insofar is Evangelium, giving a fleeting glimpse of joy. Joy beyond the walls of the world, poignant as grief. So what does he mean by, in the face of much evidence, if you will, okay, talking about deliverance, okay? He says it's the joy of deliverance. It denies, in the face of much evidence, if you will, universal final defeat. What is the face of much evidence? What did the United States feel like? Use your imaginations. On December 8th, 1941. What happened on December 7th, 1941? Pearl Harbor was attacked. Our Western fleet was pretty much demolished. Fortunately, our aircraft carriers were not in Pearl at the time. Okay? What did the United States, if you can remember it, feel like on September 12th, 2001? I mean, the attacks of September 11th, to an extent, brought us to our knees. Did it bring us face down to the ground? No. Okay? That's not even a close to this idea of universal final defeat. Where do you have to get to this idea that we almost lost? Okay. What if D-Day had not been a success? All those troops, all those ships, what if the ships all sank in the English Channel? What if all the troops who landed on the beaches of Normandy and the paratroopers who dropped in behind enemy lines into France had all been killed, and D-Day turned out to be an utter military disaster? Would the world be different? Probably. What if Hitler had won World War II? That would have looked like utter final defeat. Put it in a personal term, it's you're the last one standing, holding off an enemy. And they're rushing at you, and you're the last one, and you're sitting there, and you've got one chamber, one round in the chamber. What does that look like? Sayonara. Looks like you're a goner, right? Okay, so this says that even in the face of that kind of impending final defeat, it denies universal final defeat. What does he mean? Well, if it's Devon against everybody else in a battle, the battle isn't what? It's not the war. It's not everything. If Britain had lost in World War II, in what was called the Battle of Britain, when the German Luftwaffe just started bombing the hell out of England. If Britain had lost that, would that have been a huge loss to the West? Yes, it would have. Would it have been universal final defeat? No, it would not have. Why not? Because you sail across the pond, and there's the United States. If Britain and the United States had lost, then you're getting a little closer to a universal final defeat. So, Tolkien says, it denies universal final defeat. It says, I might die, but the battle will go on. Okay? It's the last scene, if you've seen it, of Rogue One. Okay? Some people die. Why? So that others can live. It's Frodo at the end of The Lord of the Rings. Frodo doesn't get to live the fat, dumb, and happy life in Middle Earth. He goes on. For him, it kind of is a defeat, but not for Sam. All right? So Tolkien says, and in its denial of this universal final defeat, it is Evangelium, an even more loaded religious term. What does that mean, Evangelium? It's Greek. It means good news. That's why those four guys who wrote those first four books of the New Testament are called the Evangelists. And those four books are called the Gospels. Old English word that means ga, comes from god, good, spell, word. Good word. Good news. Okay? Tolkien says, it's Evangelium. It is a spreading of good news. What's the good news? Giving a fleeting glimpse of joy. Joy what? Beyond the confines of this world. In other words, it's as if the fairy story, to use another image from another work of fantasy literature and or film, it's as if fairy story at this moment kind of pulls the curtain back. And we see deeper into reality. That is, we see more than we just normally see with our two physical eyes. We see something deeper, a spiritual truth. I don't necessarily mean spiritual, a religious truth, like an Islamic truth or a Jewish truth or a Christian truth. I mean a real kind of metaphysical truth, something else. Okay? Doesn't mean you get a glimpse of God or Jesus or the saints or whatever. What might it mean you get a glimpse of? Maybe yourself? Maybe something about human nature? Maybe something about interactions with others? Okay? And he calls this joy beyond the walls of the world poignant as grief. It's the mark of a good fairy story, of the higher or more complete kind, that however wild its events, however fantastic or terrible the adventures, it can give to child or man that hears it. When this occurs, a catch of the breath, a beat and lifting of the heart, a moment. The thing that kind of takes your breath away for just a moment. Near to, or indeed accompanied by tears, as keen as that given by any form of literary art. Okay. Where does that occur in the, if you're familiar with it, the first Star Wars film? Is it the destruction of the Death Star? I don't think so. I think it's just before the destruction of the Death Star. It's when Han Solo reappears. Because Luke, you know, he gets ready to go out and fight the Death Star. What does Luke have in his mind? I'm going to die. You're going to go off and you're going to, you know, get your treasure. You're going to go off and be rich, he says to Han Solo. No, you go ahead, look out for yourself. It seems to be what you do best. Ooh, not very good parting words, right? You don't want to say to the person you love the most in the world, well, screw you, because what might happen 6 hours later? So he says essentially that. And while all of Luke's, you know, compatriots are getting blasted out of the sky by Darth Vader and others, out of nowhere comes Han Solo. Do you expect that when you first watch the film? No. You think Han Solo's gone. He's jumped to light speed. He's out of the gap. And he shows up out of nowhere. Okay. That's the you catastrophe in that book. Or excuse me, in that film. Is there a eucatastrophe here? Yes, there is. We'll talk about it in just a moment. Okay. So, let's close this and jump to Madeline Lingle's A Wrinkle in Time. Notice on the front, it's got the Newbery Medal because it was a Newbery Award winner. John Newbery was a 18th century? Late 17th, I think, early 18th century publisher, published a lot of stuff, but he kind of begins children's literature. He begins publishing books for children. Initially, they're kind of like quiz books. I mean, they're game kind of books, right? And then gradually kind of takes a different turn, starts to publish what we would kind of call fairy tales, etc. And so in the 1920s, this guy named, I think it is John Melcher, who was a librarian, created what's called the Newbery Award. All right. And since that time, there has been every year a Newbery Medal winter, since like 1922-23. Right? In 1963, the year after she published this, Madeline Lingle won the Newbery Award for children's literature for this book. The other major award for children's literature is a Caldecott Medal. That's for illustrations. Obviously, there are no illustrations in here, so there are no awards for that. Goodnight Moon, if you're familiar with the board book, won the Caldecott Award, I think, when it was first published. Madeline Lingle, when she wrote this, she had already written several other books. Okay. But when she started shopping this around to publishers, or her agent did, she didn't have very much luck. In fact, she had really no luck. Like J.K. Rowling with Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone, she sent this to over 20 publishers. Actually, it's 26. And they all rejected it. In fact, it was when she got her 26th rejection letter, she told her agent, stop, pull it back. Don't send it out any more places. And the agent, I think it was, she tells us in the back here, or somebody else, a friend of somebody said, hold on, you need to talk to this person. Farrar of Farrar Straus Giroux Publishers. Talked to that person. They said, we'll publish it. And it became kind of like The Hobbit, international bestseller. Okay? And you have at the back of this, I don't know if you read it or not, but you have at the back of this a series of questions and just had a little interview with her. But you also have her Newbery speech, the speech writers have to give when they receive the award. And she kind of says some things in the speech that echo what Tolkien said in the fairy story essay. Okay? But one interesting thing that she says both in here and in the interview was she didn't set out to write a message. She says, when somebody asked her, you know, why did you write this? She said, I had to. She said, this is a book that forced itself on me. Okay? She couldn't answer necessarily why. At the time, she was reading a lot of science. Now keep in mind when this is. 1962, it gets published in 62. She wins the Newbery in 63. What happens late in 1963? October to be exact. The Cuban Missile Crisis. Okay? Famous book called something like 12 Days in October, where the world came, you know, with the idea of the nuclear clock and midnight is boom. The world came to like 15 seconds to nuclear Armageddon. It's happened a couple of other times since then, only we never knew about it until much, much later. And the reason it's nearly happened a couple of times since then was because of little things like switch malfunctions, a burned out bulb. I mean, we went red alert, the Soviets went red alert because of a faulty switch in one of our programming systems. Okay. The guy looking at it said, this can't be real. And he just didn't obey the protocols that said, notify the president and, you know, press the buttons, essentially. So, she writes this. What's the central conflict? Every novel has a conflict. What's the central conflict behind this novel, or in this novel?
You're trying to find your dad.
Okay. Meg and Charles Wallace's father is missing. So is it a whodunit? Is it a mystery? Why is he missing? Is it all about merely finding daddy? It is to an extent in Meg's mind, right? Why is it so important for Meg that she get her father back? And we'll talk about it when we get into the meat of the novel.
Because he can make everything better.
Bingo. Meg thinks father will make everything well. What happens when she sees him? What does he do? He makes it worse in her mentality. Okay? Describe Meg. Louder?
Clumsy?
Impatient. Is she physically clumsy? Or is she kind of like emotionally, relationally clumsy? Okay? Impatient? What else? Bellicose? I mean, she's right there in your face with a lot of people. Except for Calvin, she's kind of in your own because he's kind of cute. What else? Describe her physically. Awkward. Describe what Meg thinks about herself physically. Ugly. She has braces. She's 12 years old. She has short hair and glasses. She doesn't think there's anything attractive about herself, especially in comparison to Mom, who's just drop-dead gorgeous and has two or three PhDs. So she's brilliant and beautiful at the same time. And Meg's thinking, I'm the ugly duckling. I have nothing to do with this family. Okay? What do others think of her? What does her mom say about her? And to her? You're like that bud. Like a rosebud. What hasn't happened yet? You haven't bloomed, Meg. She says, I was the same as you. And Meg's like, get out of here. No way. Okay? What happens when she and Calvin meet? What does Calvin see in Meg? You know, there's the one scene, they're off in the woods. She's crying. She takes her glasses off. He pulls out a handkerchief, dries her tears. And what does he say? You've got gorgeous eyes, he says. But nobody ever sees them. Why? Because they're behind these thick Coke lens, you know, Coke bottle lens kind of glasses. And she's just completely taken aback. I can't believe it. This guy who's 2 or 3 years older, tall, athletic, smart, brainy, thinks I'm gorgeous. Okay. Why the emphasis on Meg's appearance in the novel? What is that part of? That Lengel seems to be addressing. Well, let me put it this way. So we have Meg, who's the oldest of the four children, the four Murray children. We've already talked about Mrs. Murray, drop dead gorgeous. Mr. Murray, we don't get much of a physical description. He's kind of tall, lanky. By the time we see him, he's got long, shaggy hair and a beard and such. But he's also brilliant. Okay. Then you have Meg. Who's next? The twins, Sandy and Dennis. Describe them. Are they awkward? No, everybody likes them. They're kind of like Fred and George Weasley. Okay. They're stocky, but they're also smart. They do what for members of their family? Protect them. They defend them. You sass about my sister. You're going to have us to deal with. How old are they? 10. 10-year-olds who are going to, you know, beat you up for bad-mouthing their 12-year-old sister. And then you have Charles Wallace. Describe Charles Wallace. Louder? Okay, he's on a spectrum. Is he your normal 5-year-old? He's extremely intelligent, very mature. He has a way of kind of reading people's minds or knowing what they're thinking. He says it's not reading minds. It's just kind of being in tune, feeling the way the wind blows. He speaks in this kind of hippie-ish language before the hippies were really big and important. Okay. So, Charles Wallace, youngest. Meg, the oldest. And they're both thought of how? By the small town that the Murrays live in. Outcast. Louder? Different. If there's one thing people don't want to be called, generally, it's what? Different. There's this idea of conformity. We want to conform. Well, let me rephrase that. Society wants us to conform with society. With its norms, with its mores, with its practices. People who don't conform are nonconformist. Okay? And therefore, because they're nonconformist, much more so in 1962 than in 2017, Because they're nonconformists, they're looked down on. They're shunned. So what do people say about May? What do they say about Charles Wallace? We hear Calvin use a word for Charles Wallace that it's implied other people regularly use, the moron. Thing is, he's the exact opposite of a moron, right? A moron is someone of substandard intelligence, sub-average intelligence. Charles Wallace is off the charts. Brilliant. Meg is maybe not off the charts, but she is brilliant. I mean, we hear, Mrs. Murray says, you know, you've both been tested. You're both, okay. Sandy and Dennis, it sounds like they're more average. And notice, they get along with everybody. Everybody likes Sandy and Dennis. Why? They're the normal ones. Okay? So Lingle is kind of wrestling with this issue of what is normal? What is abnormal? Okay. Why is this considered children's literature? Is it because the central figure is a 12-year-old girl? And if you want to say Charles Wallace, a 5-year-old boy? Does that make it children's literature because it's about two children? Is Huck Finn children's literature? How old is Huck? Early teens? Tom Sawyer? Same thing. So why are those classics of American adult, not adult, you know, triple X? Why are those just American literature and not children's literature? Are there quote-unquote adult themes? Does this have adult themes? Is fitting in with society an adult theme? Or is it something only teens go through? No. Every one of you, hopefully, God willing, will have a job. Maybe in your chosen profession. What is that job going to require of you? That you fit in. When people go up for tenure in the university, they're evaluated on a variety of qualities. Their teaching, their research, their service, that kind of stuff. But within those, each department also looks at a thing called collegiality. That is, do they fit? Does this person fit with his or her colleagues? Put it a different way, do they play nicely? Or are they a constant irritation to others? Because if they're a constant irritation, I mean, what is one of Trump's greatest, how do I put this, bad qualities? Does he play nice? No, he doesn't. He plays to keep. He plays to win, which means what? Brash, in your face. Okay? And most people say, you know, those aren't necessarily the best qualities. You know, a little humility goes a long way, blah, 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 you know, all that kind of stuff. Okay? Start at the beginning. Let's back up. I have no idea who the people are, and I don't think I've ever even seen this dedication. For Charles Wadsworth Camp and Wallace Collin Franklin. It's obviously where she gets Charles Wallace, but I have, again, no idea who these people are. Actually, Charles Wadsworth Camp. Camp is Madeline Lingle's real last name. And when she got married, she didn't take her husband's name, but her real name is Madeline Lingle Camp. Her birth name. So I'm imagining, oh, that's right. Yeah. Charles Wadsworth Kemp is her father, I believe. And Wallace Collin Franklin, Franklin is her husband's name. Last name. Okay. Okay. Look how it begins. It was a dark and stormy night. Okay, we get all that. I'm going to skip a bunch. So, because it's a dark and stormy night, and the house is rocking and shaking and such, Meg goes downstairs. Okay, and Charles Wallace is down there, and then Mrs. Murray comes down. And Charles Wallace, you know, fixes them something to eat and such. And we find out, you know, Meg's not had a good day. I can't find my marked up copy, so I had to quickly mark up some stuff this morning. Pages 14 and following, they're talking about Charles Wallace, who again is there. And Mrs. Murray tells Meg, when Meg says, "I don't want him to grow up to be dumb like me." "Oh, my darling, you're not dumb. You're like Charles Wallace. Your development has to go at its own pace. It just doesn't happen to be the usual pace." Notice this idea of the usual, the norm. "Meg, how do you know? How do you know I'm not dumb? Isn't it just because you love me that it's... Aren't you just saying that because you're my mother and you love me? I love you, but that's not what tells me. Mother and I have given you a number of tests, you know." Okay? "Yes, that was true." She's remembering a conversation with her father. Meg had realized that some of the games her parents played with her were tests of some kind. IQ test? Yes, some of them. "Is my IQ okay?" "More than okay." "What is it?" "I'm not going to tell you." But more than okay implies what? You know, average IQ is something like 110 to 120, 120 being on the good side, 110 being on the, you know, more the average side. 130, 140, you hit 160, your genius level. I think 180 is the top, and Einstein was off the top, as an example. "I'm not going to tell you. But tells me you and Charles Wallace will be able to do pretty much whatever you like when you grow up to yourselves. In other words, you won't have any problem finding a job." Okay? So, Charles Wallace and Mrs. Murray are there and talking, and we find out about the kind of day Meg had. What do we know about Meg? Look at page 17. Okay, we're reading about Meg's appearance and Mrs. Murray's. Mrs. Murray has flaming red hair, you know, skin creamy white, blah, 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 blah. Meg's hair had been passable as long as she wore it tidily in braids. When she went into high school, it was cut. And now she and her mother struggled with putting it up. But one side would come out curly and the other straight, so that she looked even plainer. How old is Meg? And she's in high school? Okay, so IQ? Just okay? No. "You don't know the meaning of moderation, do you?" Mrs. Murray says. "A happy medium is something I wonder if you'll ever learn." What's one of the later chapters called? A happy medium. And the person is a medium, okay? We're going to hear the brothers, the twins, refer to a happy medium. "That's a nasty bruise the Henderson boy gave you. By the way, shortly after you'd gone to bed, his mother called up to complain about how badly you'd hurt him. The Henderson boy is older than Meg. I told her that since he's a year older and at least 25 pounds heavier than you are, I thought I was the one who ought to be doing the complaining." Notice what Mrs. Murray does not do. "Oh, I'm so sorry. My daughter won't beat up your son anymore." She essentially says, "Your son's bigger and heavier than my daughter. You should be apologizing to me." Plus the whole thing a boy shouldn't hit girls, but you know. Meg says, "Usually no matter what happens, people think it's my fault, even if I have nothing to do with it at all." Okay. Meg says, "I hate being an oddball." An oddball. Not being like everybody else. Mrs. Murray tells her, "Give yourself time, This is probably why this is considered children's literature. Meg is going through the throes of adolescence. Is that it? Because when you read the other books in the time quintet, quartet, whichever it is, and then you the other books that involve Meg and Calvin's children after they get married, this is an issue Meg has. Even when she's older, of still kind of, you know, being the odd bird out. Right? So they start to talk about the tramp and such. Charles Wallace mentions it's probably Mrs. What's-It. Mrs. What's-It shows up. She's the tramp who's been stealing bed sheets. Page 27. Okay. She just kind of blurts out as she's getting her boots pulled off. Speaking of ways, pet, by the way, there is such a thing as a tesseract. Mrs. Murray went very white, and with one hand reached backward and clutched at a chair for support. What did you say? I said that there is a tesseract. Meg, what's wrong? What's the matter? How could she have known? Notice, do we get an explanation right then of what a tesseract is? Nope, we're left clueless. Okay? When Lingle writes this, that idea of a tesseract, okay, is still fairly new in physics circles. But she's been reading physics journals, reading about the space-time continuum and how it might be possible to travel from one place to another in both time and space. Okay? The example that's used is, this is what we normally think of as space and time. You know, it's like this. But what if you could do this? Then you just go from here to here rather than having to make this whole journey. Another way of looking at it is like this. The idea of a wormhole that possibly exists in the universe or between multiple universes or multiverses, as they are called. So she's starting to introduce these scientific ideas. Is this science fiction? Little thing at the back says, you know, she's writing in two major genres, fantasy and science fiction. She's not writing in science fiction at all. How do you know? Do we ever get a description of how tesserine occurs? No. Do we get a mathematical equation for tesserine? No, we do not. If we started to get that kind of information, yeah, then it would be science fiction. But it's not, right? So, Meg asks the next morning, what's a tesseract? It's a concept. Mrs. Murray says, I'll try to explain it to you later. It's not time before school. Okay? So, the twins come down. They tell Meg and Mother that they shouldn't let old tramps in the house without having them down so that they could protect them. They're 10-year-olds. How much protection are they going to be? Okay? Sandy says, page 30, I wish you wouldn't be such a dope, Meg. What's he doing there? What's he inadvertently, I think, doing? Feeding her notions of her not being smart enough, her not fitting in, her not being normal. You don't have to take everything so personally. Use a happy medium, for heaven's sake. You just goof around in school and look out the window. Don't pay any attention. Just before class, I was looking up. Let's see if I still have it pulled up. I don't, but in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 7, verse 16. The writer says, Solomon writes, do not be over-righteous, neither be over-wise. Why destroy yourself? Do not be over wicked. So notice, don't be over righteous, over good. Don't be over wicked, over bad. And do not be a fool. Why die before your time? It is good to grasp the one and not let go of the other. Whoever fears God will avoid all extremes. What's that another way of saying? Find a happy medium. Moderation in all things, Epicurus said. Okay? So, use a happy medium. Dennis, you just make things harder for yourself. And Charles Wallace is going to have an awful time next year when he starts school. Okay, he's 5 now. He's going to start school when he's 6. We know he's bright, but he's so funny when he's around other people. They're so used to thinking he's dumb. I don't know what's going to happen to him. So the two brothers are thinking, you know, if you don't kind of settle down, imagine the problems Charles Wallace is going to have. Sandy and I sock anybody picks on him, but that's about all we can do. Mrs. Murray, let's not worry about next year until we get through this one. Why does she say that? What is next year?
Long ways away.
What does she mean? Let's not worry about next year until we get through this one. What is this year? It's now. It's tomorrow. It's the day after tomorrow. It's the day after that. In other words, how do we experience time? Do we experience time through tessering? No, we don't. We experience it moment by moment. Mrs. Murray is suggesting, without actually saying it, kind of what Tolkien says about fairy stories, teaching. She is suggesting, live each moment. Okay? In other words, let Charles Wallace be the way he is today. And then tomorrow, let him be the way he is. Let Meg be the way she is today. What has she said earlier? Don't worry, it'll happen. You'll bloom. Just not in the normal time. In what? Your time. Okay? At school, we find out Meg has problems. The teacher tells her, if you're going to be rude, you may leave the room. Well, what is Meg being rude about? In social studies, page 30, she was asked to name the principal imports and exports of Nicaragua. This is in 1962. All right? And although she had looked them up dutifully the evening before, now she could remember none of them. The teacher was sarcastic. The rest of the class laughed. She flung herself down in her seat in a fury. Who cares about the imports and exports of Nicaragua anyhow, she murmured. I'm sure somebody in here knows about the imports and exports of Nicaragua. After all, this is 55 years later after the book was written. How important is that knowledge for your well-being in life? Only thing I know that Nicaragua exports, because I like to smoke them, cigars. Everything else? Communism. Not a whole lot. Okay. What kind of education is Meg receiving that she's rebelling against? Okay, useless. Okay. It's just facts. It's just facts. What is it not about? Life. Have any of you read C.S. Lewis's Chronicles of Narnia? A couple of you. In The Voyage of the Dawn Treader, one of the boys, Eustace Scrub, goes off on this voyage. He enters this fairyland called Narnia and such. And we get a description of Eustace Scrub at the beginning of the novel. He loves this kind of information. And his parents, Lewis writes, in the 1950s, are very progressive people. This is the kind of education they want their son to have, not the good kind. What does he mean by the good kind? Reading stories about knights and quests and virtues. Okay? And so what happens in the story is Eustace Scrub turns into a dragon. Literally, he turns into a dragon. And he must become undragon. Well, why does he become a dragon in the first place? Because he's a greedy SOB. And he wanders away from everybody else, and he finds a cave, and in the cave is a dragon's hoard. And on the hoard is a dead dragon. And he's thinking, dragon's dead. And he falls asleep on the hoard, and guess what? He becomes the dragon. Okay? It's a little bit of allegory there about, you know, becoming what you really are. So, Meg has to go to the principal. Describe the principal, Mr. Jenkins. How does Mr. Jenkins talk about Meg's family? This guy got fired today.
He's in like a gossipy sort of way.
Yeah. Well, what's this about your father? He's still missing. You know, and what about that oddball brother of yours? Okay. And Meg's like, you know my mother, right? He goes, yes, I know your mother. Yeah, you know, she's got multiple PhDs. Do you think she's just kind of wish fulfillment stuff going on with my father? Well, you know, your mother's a very beautiful and smart woman, and I would presume to imagine what she's thinking. What does he mean? Yeah, he's not coming back. Okay. So, Meg doesn't get along well with him. So she and Charles Wallace, when they get home from school, go off to the shack where Charles Wallace says Mrs. Watson is staying. As they are out there, they meet up with Calvin O'Keefe. And they start to talk a little bit. In page 38... Charles Wallace says, tell us what you're doing here. What is this, third degree? Aren't you the one who's supposed to be a moron? Meg flushed with rage, but Charles Wallace said, that's right. If you want to call my dog off, you better give, because Fortinbras the dog is going after him. Calvin, most peculiar moron I've ever met. I came to get away from my family. What kind of family? Well, they're all sick, red runny noses. He says, I'm third from the top of 11 kids. Notice, he's not the eldest, he's not the youngest. He's what? Third from the top of, he's in the middle. Okay? There's a thing called middle child syndrome. It's even bigger for him. So, Calvin's kind of surprised by Charles Wallace. Says, I was told you couldn't talk. Thinking I'm a moron gives people something to feel smug about. Why should I disillusion them? Why should I make them feel that he's a five-year-old using words like disillusion? Okay. How old are you, Cal? 14, 2 years older than me. What grade? Junior. A 14-year-old junior. So what's that telling us also about Calvin? Either he's really super smart, or kids advanced in grades at earlier years in 1962. Than they do now. Okay? So they continue talking. They go to the shack and they meet the three ladies. I'm going to skip a bunch. The ladies start to explain time. About pages 49 and following. Did they not order? They ordered that one? Mm-hmm. Okay.
This one's like 8 or 10 pages off.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry about that. They were supposed to order this one. So they talk about time travel, etc. And around, okay, so am I 8 or 10 pages ahead or behind?
You're ahead.
I'm ahead. So maybe around page 44, 43, Meg says, I like to understand things. We all do, but it isn't always possible. Charles Wallace understands more than the rest of us. Doesn't he? Yes. Why? Well, because he's different, man. Different how? Not quite sure. You know yourself, he's not like, what page is
44.
That is 44. Okay. Wanting doesn't have anything to do with it. Charles Wallace is what he is. Different. New. Yes, that's what your father and I feel. This is Meg's mother talking. But Charles Wallace doesn't look different from anybody else. No, Meg, but people are more than just the way they look. Charles Wallace's difference isn't physical. It's in essence. What is Mrs. Murray really saying? Everybody's essence is different. Okay, Charles Wallace is more different than everybody else. She says, well, I know he's different. I know he's something more. I guess I'll just have to accept it without understanding it. Mrs. Murray, that's the point I was trying to get across. Notice, you don't have to understand everything. What does that mean, however? Mrs. Murray saying, you do have to accept it. What are some things we have to accept in life? Think of Tolkien for creative fantasy as founded upon the hard recognition that things are so in the world as it appears under the sun, upon a recognition of fact, but not a slavery to it. What are some of those facts that we have to accept? Doesn't mean we can't try to change them, but we have to accept them. There is unfairness. You have to accept that. If you don't accept that, you are going to have a life that is very poor, nasty, brutish, and short. Because you won't last. Okay? So, they keep talking about their visitor of last night and such. And they talk about father and how he's a physicist, PhD several times over. And they start to talk about time and such again. And Calvin and Meg go out of the house, and Meg starts to cry. Let's see, about page 50, I guess. And Calvin says, why don't you cry? You're just crazy about your father, aren't you? Go ahead, cry. It'll do you good. I cry much too much. I should be like mother. I should be able to control myself. Your mother's a completely different person. She's a lot older than you are. I wish I were a different person. I hate myself. Calvin reaches over, pulls off her glasses, pulls out a handkerchief, wipes off her tears. This gesture of tenderness undid her completely. In other words, she just melts. She puts her head down on her knees and just boo-hoos. She says, I'm sorry, I'm terribly sorry, now you'll hate me. He says, you are a moron. You're an idiot, Meg. Don't you know you're the nicest thing that's happened to me in a nice time or in a long time? Describe Calvin O'Keefe's home. Not good, okay? Why? Give me more description. His mom's terrible. How? Doesn't take care of herself. Is somewhat abusive. A lot of yelling going on. Is there much love expressed in the home? No. So he likes now to go over the Murray house. Why? Because love is flowing out the doors and windows. Even though Sandy and Dennis tell Meg she's a moron. It's said how? Lovingly. Meg, I love you, but you're a moron. It's like when I talk with my siblings. Because me and most of my siblings, some of my siblings, we're completely different, opposite political spectrum. And it's like, I love you, but you're an idiot, you know, kind of a thing. Okay? It's that first part that's the important part, however. So, Meg says, if Charles Wallace is a sport, I think I'm a biological mistake. She's waiting to be contradicted. But Calvin says, you know, it's the first time I've seen you without your glasses. Blind as a bat without them. You know, you've got dreamboat eyes. You go right on wearing your glasses. I don't think I want anybody else to see what gorgeous eyes you have. Okay. Now this is Calvin hitting on her. And she's kind of like, duh. She's a little slow, though she does understand it. Okay. The next chapter, the black thing. I'm going to skip some here. What is the black thing? That they have to try to see through to see to where the father is.
She's kind of evil.
Page 83. Meg asks, that dark thing we saw, is that what my father is fighting? Chapter 5, yes. Mrs. Witch says, he is behind the darkness so that even we cannot see him. Meg sobs, cries. Okay. So they've got to try to figure out how to get to where he is. And so they explain the tesseract with a string, and you do have little drawings to show it. Okay. So Charles Wallace says, page 88, okay, so now you understand time is one dimension, space is another, so you now get width, okay? So a third dimension, you put it into mathematical terms, so you've got the square. He says, okay. Page 75 in yours. Charles Wallace says, that's right, good girl, okay. So for the fifth dimension, you'd square the fourth, right? She goes, okay. Well, the fifth dimension is the tesseract. You add that to the other four dimensions, and you could travel through space without having to go the long way along. She goes, I get it. I understand. Calvin, did you get it? He's like, kind of struggling. So they have to get taken off to where Mr. Murray is. And at the end of that chapter, they find out people have been fighting this dark thing for years. Okay. Mrs. What's It says, probably around page 90, 92 or so in yours. Excuse me, 87 in yours. We're not alone, you know, children, said Mrs. What's It. Oh, good grief. Not nearly where I need to be. We're not alone, you know, children. All through the universe, it's being fought. All through the cosmos. And my, but it's a grand and exciting battle. I know it's hard for you to understand about size, how there's very little difference in the size of the tiniest microbe, the greatest galaxy, etc., etc. So, Calvin says, who's fighting it? Who've been our fighters? Oh, you must know them, dear. Calvin's like, oh. And so Mrs. Who quotes, and the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehendeth it not. It's the opening to St. John's Gospel. It's in the opening. It's not the exact opening. Charles Wallace says, Jesus! Not Jesus! Exclamation. He's saying, Jesus was one of the fighters. Why, of course. Mrs. Watson, of course. Go on, Charles. There were others, all your great artists. Leonardo da Vinci, Michelangelo, Shakespeare, Bach, Pasteur, Madame Curie. Madame Curie, Pasteur, what are they fighting? What did Louis Pasteur give us? Pasteurization process, pasteurized milk. So what's the difference between milk straight from the cow and pasteurized milk? What is the process of pasteurization do? It kills microbes. Kills germs. What did Marie Curie do? Discovered radiation. X-rays. Are those good or bad? Depends on how many of them you get, you know. Okay. So Mrs. Wetzel says, okay, Meg, now you, come on, give me one of our fighters. Euclid. Yeah. Jump. No, he's one of the bad guys, from my way of thinking. Geometry, bad. You know. Literature, arts, good. Okay. So, Mrs. Witch says, we're going to your father. So, they take them to the happy medium. Okay, we're going to have to stop there. We'll finish this on Thursday. So, like I said, we'll get behind. And so, we're behind. Let me turn this off so we can go off. Okay, the quiz. Just over the fairy story essay. When you're done, just turn it in and feel free to leave.